I've been wandering the streets for days, desperately searching for food and water. I can't find a safe place to sleep, and I'm freezing cold. Suddenly, a van pulls up next to the curb, and a man gets out. He looks at me for a while, and I look back at him. Does he have food for me? Does he have water? The next thing I know, he puts a noose around my neck. I try to run, but it's too late. He puts me in the van, and he takes me away. Now that I have your attention, let me introduce myself. They call me Millie at the animal shelter. They have labeled me a stray dog. I've been on my own for so long that I can't remember ever being part of a family. Not all of the others here are like me. Some are here because they are injured or abused. Others were lost or, sadly, given up by their families. I am one of 21,000 dogs and cats that will come to the shelter each year. Will I be one of the 14,000 that are killed because I wasn't adopted? People walk past my cage and hardly glance my way because I am dirty and scraggly. If they would ignore how I look, then they would see who I am. If they would just look into my eyes, I would melt their hearts. I would love them always and never let them go because they chose me. They saved my life. I'll be eager to please them and listen better than any dog they have ever had before. It's okay if you don't have a lot of money. I am not expensive, like the purebreds or the puppies at the pet stores. The low cost to adopt me includes my shots, tags, and spaying. These fees help to feed and take care of the other animals in the shelter. It also pays for the doctors who care for us when we are brought in. My time is running out. I only have 5 days before I'm euthanized, which means killed. You can save me. It is such a small price to pay for a lifetime of love, affection, and memories. Shelters are overcrowded, and animals are being killed every day. Some animals in the shelter may look scruffy, but are really sweethearts, and they have a good home. It is not that expensive to save a loving animal's life. It is important that you know how desperately we want a home like the one you have. Don't you think that we deserve that special family to love us? I am a lucky one. Someone looked at me and I melted her heart. I am now part of a loving, caring family. Please help the other animals in the shelter. Please, take home what can be the love of your life today.
Have you ever been bullied or seen anyone get bullied? Have you ever done anything about it? When I mean bullied, I mean unwanted, aggressive behavior directed at your peers that involves a real or perceived power imbalance. In kid terms, it would be teasing, insulting, hitting, shoving, excluding someone, or gossiping about someone. In case you didn't know, there are 4 types of bullying. They are physical bullying, verbal bullying, social bullying, and cyberbullying. Physical bullying means hitting, slapping, shoving, and other physical impacts towards someone. Verbal bullying means name-calling, repeated teasing, and gossiping behind someone's back. Social bullying involves hurting someone's reputation and relationships. For example, not letting them be on your kickball team or sit with you at lunch. Cyberbullying is most likely done on social networks and through technology. This is done by sending negative text messages or leaving nasty voicemails. All 4 types of bullying can be interrelated. That means someone could do all 4 types of bullying to another person at the same time. What would you do if you got bullied? Well, one thing you could do is walk away and stay away. Or you could talk clearly and calmly to the bully. If that doesn't work, you could laugh it off or you could joke about it. That would be very easy if you make up good jokes. However, if the bully is physically attacking you, I say, run! There are a few things you should do if you see someone being bullied. First, you should report it to a teacher or an adult you trust. Second, you could fill out a bullying form including some important details about the incident. These 2 ways allow you to take action on the bullying without the fear of getting bullied back for telling. 1 out of 7 kids in kindergarten through 12th grade are bullied or have witnessed bullying. How many of you have witnessed bullying? 1 out of 5 kids who bully do this to fit in or to be popular. Attention bullies, you are not cool. People should like you for who you are and not how mean you are. Now that I've given you this information, will you bully or will you stand up to a bully? Take a moment to think about how others feel about bullying and how it affects them. So take a stand and lend a hand.
You must be the change you wish to see in the world. That is a famous quote from Mohandas Gandhi. Now I know you're probably thinking, oh, this is going to be such a boring speech. But it's not. I'm just telling you the truth. Anyone can make a change. Including you. Think of all those famous inventors or skilled politicians. Heck, even book writers that made a change in the world. Perhaps you will be like Benjamin Franklin, who made many useful inventions. Or maybe Martin Luther King, who helped give blacks equal rights. Possibly even Helen Keller, who was blind and deaf, but still became an influential campaigner. You can be anyone or anything you want, as long as you put your mind to it and some effort in it. I've made a change once. Of course, it wasn't very much, but it did help my dad a lot. What I did was chores, and because of the work I did in my dad's free time, he was able to get some money. A change doesn't have to be worldwide. You can start small and then bloom big, sort of like the company Shriners Hospital. Just think of what you could do. You can make inventions, inspire others, and even break world records. I mean, who doesn't want to own their very own water park? Or even do something as simple as getting straight A's on your report card? Think about a career you want to have when you grow up. Writer, artist, Squidward, anything. You have to work towards certain goals to get that job. Remember, even if you fail in your attempt to make a change, it's okay. You didn't really fail because you tried. Plus, the next time you try, you would have learned from your mistake. The only true way to fail is to give up. Finally, here are the ingredients for a change. Number one, knowledge and a plan. Use your noodle. Number two, effort. Varying amounts. And number three, an act. The act is one half of your entire change. This is a recipe for success in your change. So just believe me. Together, we can make a change.
Here come the Gators! Those words fill me with joy on a Saturday afternoon. It's time for a Florida Gator football game. While I cheer for the orange and blue, you may cheer for one of the other 119 Division I college football teams. But what we all have in common is team spirit. In stadiums across the nation, approximately 49 million fans attend football games each year, and each of them share a tradition of team spirit. All teams have a tradition of cheerleaders cheering, the band playing, and of course, the wave. While these traditions are standard at most sports games, other teams may have more specific traditions. For example, the University of Arkansas cheers their team on by yelling, "Woo, Pig Suey!" This cheer began with local farmers in the 1920s. At the University of Colorado, a huge buffalo named Ralphie scampers across the field. Can you imagine a full-size buffalo on a football field? Those traditions may be crazy, but some fans can take team spirit to the extreme. If you're a Gator fan, you may have heard of Mr. Two-Bits. Mr. Two-Bits led a cheer for 60 seasons and retired in 2008. I was lucky enough to attend his last game. Other fans, like Tony Brandino, go to 500 games without missing one. And there's no denying Nathan Davis's love for the Alabama Crimson Tide. He has Alabama tattoos all over his body, showing the world his passion for the Crimson Tide. Now, here's a question I have for you. This season, when college football is back, will you raise your bullhorns in the air for South Florida? Will you do the tomahawk chop for the Seminoles? Or will you join me decked out in orange and blue, cheering on the Florida Gators and doing the Gator Chomp.
There are two main teams that you will pick to be on for the rest of your dear lives. Those teams are called the Followers and the Leaders. Your job right now is to choose which team you will be on because that will affect your lifestyle, your personality, and how you will treat other people. I don't mean to pressure you, but this decision will be very, very important. Being a leader means that you follow your own person, that you like what you want to like, and you don't rely on others to pick your personality. With the long list of great leaders in our history, Mahatma Gandhi inspired me the most. He was able to lead India to independence using nonviolent actions. He once said, "I will not let anyone walk through my mind with their dirty feet." For me, that means don't let anyone dictate who you're going to be because they're not you. You don't always have to be in the front to be a leader. If you're able to influence somebody and set a good example, then you, my friend, are a leader. Now, being a follower is just the total opposite of being a leader. It means that you do rely on others to pick your personality, that you like what other people like, and you don't follow your own person. There are tons of reasons why people become followers, but here's the main reason: peer pressure. Peer pressure is like the flu, except it only affects certain people. People who are left out and want to fit in, or people who think they'll be bullied if they don't follow the current fad. In my opinion, being a leader is way better than being a follower. You know why? Well, if you're a leader, you have the freedom to do things your way and have your own style. If you're a follower, you have to constantly follow what other people are doing, and that gets tiring after a while. So, do you have an idea of what each team is like? Good. Now's the time for you to choose. Are you going to be a follower or a leader? Like I mentioned before, this decision will be very, very important, so I suggest that you choose wisely. I've decided to be a leader. Where are you going to be?
Plus, minus, multiply, divide. I hate math. I can even get higher than a C. But guess what I got in my last report card grade? A D. That is horrible. Come on, in math? Phew-wee. I'm in a fifth grade classroom feeling like a kindergartner, not knowing what to do. Now that's really sad. It's just that division. Oh man, honestly, if you'd ask me, I'd rather be locked in a freezer for 15 whole hours than doing division. But you know, we all have to do math. Let's get back on topic, shall we? Anyways, like I said, it's just that division. My teacher, Miss Hill, started to explain it to me, but I was lost at the word remainder. I'm stuck here today wondering what in the world is a remainder. I know you know, but I don't. Also, every single time when I hear kids say step one, step two, step three, it's almost like all the steps get kicked out of my brain. It's so hard to explain it myself. I'm on square one here, people. I need some help. Well, since we got that division out of the way, let me tell you about when I get home. Well, when I get home, I'm trying to subtract math from my brain. Like, give me a break here. So after like 5 whole hours of subtracting math out of my brain, my mom calls me out for dinner. So of course I rush out for dinner. Who wouldn't? And then I look at my dinner plate. OMG. It is divided into portions. There's more math added to my brain. And then I look at the clock. It is 30 minutes past bedtime. Oh, why didn't you look at that? It is math. It's like math is my monster. It like haunts me, literally. Like every single sentence I say has math. So when I added all this speech stuff up and I subtracted how long it has taken me to do this, and then I divided every single time I'm on a chore to the list, equal math is everywhere. I mean, everywhere. Watch out for the math monster. Oh, and one more thing. I'm still stuck on remainder.
Doug Larson once said life expectancy would grow by leaps and bounds if green vegetables smelled like bacon. True, but false. When you think about exercise, nutrition, and childhood obesity, sometimes you ask questions. Questions like, why should I care? How much should I weigh? And what can I do? You can exercise, eat healthier food choices, and even set goals for yourself. It's never about shape or size, but whether or not you're healthy. You should care, because if things get out of hand, you can develop many different illnesses. So do yourself a favor and start to take action. I don't mean to be a potty pooper, but there are plenty of ways life expectancy could grow. So much you wouldn't know what to do with yourself. Back in the day, millions of years ago, when disco was invented, there were no high-tech cell phones or even internet. Think about it. How did our parents survive? By going outside and playing sports to stay active. You should have at least 1 hour of play every single day. You should also have one serving per fruit or vegetable. Have you ever heard of the saying, an apple a day keeps the doctor away? Well, it's true. Childhood obesity is a very serious illness. It affects millions of children across the U.S. When you don't go outside to burn off the unwanted calories or attempt to eat healthier food choices, it weighs you down mentally and physically. So start to set goals for living your healthy, happy life. You'll be supported by your friends and family. There are many downfalls and diseases to childhood obesity. High blood pressure, diabetes, heart conditions, and many more. Trust me, I don't think it's all that fun. For example, with diabetes, you barely get to eat any sweets. Is it worth skipping your daily fruit? I don't think so. We've learned about exercise, nutrition, childhood obesity, and what sometimes happens when you don't take care of yourself. Illnesses. So whenever you have the time, get up, put down those gadgets, and stop being a couch potato that eats potato chips. Why are you still sitting there? Get up! I don't know about you, but I certainly have many things to do, including math homework, and lots of life left to live. So take my advice. You'll thank me one day.
Do you think babysitting is easy? Well, if you chose yes, change your mind. If you think it's so easy, why don't you try babysitting my 3-year-old cousin? I survived the day, but I'm not sure if you can. You have a better chance of getting bit by a dog. But if you seriously want to babysit, then here's some tips and how it all started. My aunt was coming over and I thought, woohoo! But I was wrong. Instead of having fun, my mom and my aunt went out to do adult things, which I like to call shopping. They left me babysitting my 3-year-old cousin named Austin. He's cute, but he's a whole lot of trouble. One more thing I forgot and wished I did forget, I also had to babysit my little sister named Vera. They say they would pay me $5. I thought it was a good deal. I thought. When they left, the first thing I hear is whining and my name being shouted across the house. I walk into the room and see Austin grabbing on Vera's shirt. Tip one, if you ever, I mean ever, try to stop someone from hurting someone else, you might get kicked. But I did get everything under control 2 minutes later. Tip two, after dealing with a tough situation, give yourself a treat. After all that commotion, I got hungry and decided to eat some ice cream. After I was finished, I headed for my room just until Austin kicked me. What was that for? I yelled. I'm hungry, he yelled back. Are you serious? I took him to the kitchen and gave him some milk. Then he started whining. I thought he wanted some cereal, so I poured him some, but that didn't help. I asked him what he wanted, and he said, candy! Oh, boy. I wished I never asked. Just when he said that, my little sister came running across the house saying, where's the candy? Where's the candy? Then I said, there aren't any. Then she started whining. Oh, goody. 2 whining kids. I looked through the fridge and luckily found 2 candy bars. I handed them the candy bars, and they finally calmed down. Tip 3, if you ever give kids or babies candy, they'll be quiet like nothing ever happened. Finally, my mom and my aunt came home, and my aunt had to go. The first thing I said was, where's my money? They paid me my money, and they had to leave. So next time you want to earn money, never choose babysitting.
Hey, I heard you were having a party. Am I invited? Sally sends on one of those public chats on a social network. No, why would I invite a loser like you? Jennifer replies. Now Sally's sad and embarrassed, feeling like an outcast, while everyone else on the social network is making fun of her. This is called cyberbullying. Cyberbullying is the use of internet or related technology to harm other people mentally. Nearly 43% of kids have been cyberbullied. 1 in 4 have had it happen to them more than once. 75% have visited a website making fun of another student. Cyberbullying is more common than normal bullying. Why? It's because it's hard to get caught. This has become a serious problem with all the new technology and social networks. You might think, oh, you can just delete your account on the social network. When in reality, it's much harder than that sometimes. They might have your number, email, or so on. Although, there are some things that can help stop this. You can always tell an adult or just ignore them. Also, you shouldn't continue to read their posts or texts because you most likely will get more upset. Many people become a cyberbully for many different reasons. Some people start because their friends are doing it and they want to be funny and look cool. Other people get cyberbullied, so they decide to cyberbully someone else. What happened to treat people the way you'd like to be treated? If this continues, it's only going to get bigger and bigger. Imagine in the future, your child is getting cyberbullied. They're depressed, and their self-esteem is low. Do you really want the future to be filled with cyberbullies? Getting cyberbullied can lead to different effects, like depression and much more. If you are caught cyberbullying someone, there are some punishments depending on the situation. If you're under 18, you could be taken to juvenile detention, and the court will decide whether to release you or not, depending on the problem. You could be placed in house arrest or be restricted from using the internet. You most likely will be forbidden to have any contact with the victim. This is why cyberbullying needs to stop. We can all help out by teaching people why it's bad and what it leads to. I guarantee this would stop cyberbullying and make the world a better place.
This is a tale of two twins. Picture this with me for a moment. Two babies the size of plums floating around in a bubble. That's about the size of my sister and I when my mom and dad found out that they would have two babies at the same time. I also imagine that was just about the time when my sister and I discovered each other. We probably bumped into each other and somehow instantly knew that we would spend the rest of our lives together. And that was the beginning of our love-dislike relationship. In the months following that moment, we became very good at kicking, punching, and stretching. First, she would kick, then I would kick, then she would punch, then I would punch. And the one we liked to do the most was stretching. And since I have long legs, it kind of worked for me. On September 11th, we were fighting about who would come out first. My sister says that I yanked her back in, and that's how I came first. But that's not what happened. My mom says that particular part hurt her way more than it hurt me. When we were one, we would have many talks in baby language, and no one could figure out what we were saying. One time, my sister just started screaming out of the blue because somehow doing her little talk, I made her mad. Boy, can that girl scream. When we hit the terrible twos, I had her on the most annoying list. She would take my favorite toys, and of course I chased it down until I got them back. But when I did, suddenly I turned into the bad guy. As time passed, our relationship started to grow stronger. Sometimes I couldn't stand her, and sometimes we could not be separated. Our first big separation came after kindergarten, and well, by then, we decided enough was enough. It was time to be in separate classes. Yes! No one knows how long I waited for that moment. Being a twin has its challenges, and trust me, I should know. I mean, I went through the aggravation, wearing the same clothes, not to mention people getting us confused all the time. Me and my sister go through our fire and ice moments, but I cannot imagine being without her. We were chosen to be a pair. Not everybody gets a partner from birth. but I was lucky enough to get one.
Imagine a world without books, a world without myths, folktales, or even fiction itself. Our lives are immersed in stories. We laugh at humorous tales and cry at dramatic ones. Heroic stories, like the tales of Batman, have the potential to inspire us. Now I will tell you some stories about people that have been inspired by the heroic tales of Batman. Now there is a boy named Kai Sapp. He's 8 years old, lives in Texas, and has leukemia. The program, A Wish with Wings, granted Kai any wish. He didn't wish for a trip to Disney World, or a cruise to the Bahamas, or even $1,000. He didn't even wish for more wishes. He wished to be Batman for a day. He was given a day where he could save people. He stopped the Joker from robbing a bank. He stopped the Riddler from blowing up the fire department building. And he also stopped a mugging. At the end of the day, Kai got the key to the city. This was all fake, but Kai loved it. He felt like he was truly making a difference. Like his hero, Batman. Now there is a man named Lenny Robinson. He spent $300,000 buying a Batmobile and a Batman costume. Do you know what he does? He's an actor. He's a stuntman. He doesn't even earn money off of what he does. He puts on his Batman costume and rides in his Batmobile all around the country to children's hospitals. He tells the kids that they need to be strong, that they can fight their illness. He tells them that they will get better. He gives them a hug and even lifts them off their feet. He gives them a toy and the kids smile. Sounds like an impossible thing, but they all smile. Lenny sometimes lets the kids sit in the Batmobile. He never would have done this if he didn't have the story of Batman in his life. Now there's a man named David O'Leary. He is a police officer that lives in Las Vegas. He was inspired to be a police officer by Batman and the stories of Batman. He goes into parts of town where there's gang violence, and he breaks up the gangs. Batman is human, so if Batman can do it, he can too. All of these people have one thing in common. They never would have done what they did without stories in their life. You may think Batman is just a silly story for children, but even a comic book hero can inspire the best in us. Batman is just an example of an inspiring story. I know, in your heart, you all know a story. An inspiring story with action, adventure, drama, and maybe even a little comedy. Tell someone that story and inspire them. It all begins with Once Upon a Time.
Wee-oo, wee-oo, wee-oo. The windows are down. The wind is flying through my golden locks, and my music is blaring. It's 6 a.m., and there's nobody on the road except me. And the cops. So they pull me over and ask why a 10-year-old is operating a Lamborghini. Well, officer, that's a really good question. But I can explain. I think that kids like me should be able to drive for three reasons. One, kids are always getting the gold medals on Mario Kart, not the parents. Two, teenagers are often speeding to impress the ladies. And three, adults get into car accidents from drinking and driving. Kids aren't even old enough to buy alcohol, so that would be one less thing for the cops to worry about. Yes, first place on Mushroom Gorge. Kids have so much hand-eye coordination. It's no wonder why we're really good at video games. But adults, for some reason, have never really gotten the hang of them. An example of this would be my mom playing Mario Kart. No matter how much private training I give her, she just keeps falling off those mushrooms, which are obstacles on a race called Mushroom Gorge. She also has a tendency to run off the road and slam into walls. And cows. And chickens. So while all the other races are evading obstacles, my mom, she's running into them. Shoom! That would be the sound of a teenager flying down the road. Speed limit's 30, he's going 60. Most teenage boys who speed are either trying to impress their girlfriend or buddies who are riding shotgun. Also, when they are texting and talking on the phone, they tend to be unaware of how hard they're actually pressing on the gas pedal. Most kids my age don't even have a phone or girlfriend or boyfriend, so there'd be a lot less speeding crashes. Drivers over the age of 21 are often involved in car accidents from drinking too much and then heading out onto the open road. Most of these crashes happen after parties. The grown-ups will go over to their friend's house to see the big game and drink a few bottles of beer. When they drive home, they get tired and their reaction time slows. This dangerously affects driving ability and judgment. Children aren't even old enough to buy alcohol, so the police will have to constantly be alert for drunk drivers. Okay, so us kids may need a booster seat to help us see the road. But all in all, the world would be a lot safer if kids were the ones driving. Unfortunately, my plea for mercy to the cops didn't quite work out as I'd planned. So my next solution? Dear Mr. President.
Have you ever heard this? The dog ate my homework. That is the worst excuse ever for not having your homework. Unless your homework is made out of bacon. And most people's homework is not made out of bacon. You know, at least one time in our lives, we have not done our homework. Just say it. I have, and I'm here to help. I have some excuses that will get you out of trouble the next time you don't do your homework. You could say something like, the FBI took it. They said they needed it for evidence. Are you really going to argue with the FBI? Or you could say something like, last night we ran out of toilet paper, and my dad was sick to his stomach, so he grabbed my homework and rushed to the bathroom. I haven't seen it since. Or you could say, last night, it was freezing cold. So then, we ran out of firewood, so we had to burn my homework to keep my family warm. What would you rather have let me do? Let them freeze to death? You could also tell your teacher, I wanted to save trees and not waste any paper. What do you have against trees? Something else that you could tell your teacher is, last night, there was a really weird accident involving a unicorn, a microwave, and frozen carrots. Don't ask. You don't want to know. If you want to get on your teacher's good side, you could say something like, morning, at breakfast, a kid was making fun of you, so I threw my homework at him to get him to stop. I was only defending you. Or you could always tell your teacher, yesterday, my sister got mad at me, so she cut my homework into little paper dolls. This last excuse is my favorite excuse. Last night, I had just finished working so hard on my homework, and then I saw a bright white light outside of my window, and it turned out to be aliens. They said they needed it for a sample of human writing, and I would have fought for it, but in all the alien movies I've seen, the aliens have deadly lasers. I hope these homework excuses will get you out of trouble the next time you don't do your homework instead of sitting there and going, Remember all of these wonderful excuses I told you about, and remember, don't panic.
Picture this. A fire ant colony attacking in swarms and biting to scare their enemy off. Fire ants are non-native to the U.S., and since their arrival from South America, they've spread to over 14 states. And everywhere you turn, you see anthills filled with maybe thousands of ants. They're considered invasive species. Invasive species are non-native species taken from their native home and placed into their non-native habitat. They are brought by humans and usually cause a problem to organisms around it. For an example, the kudzu plant is an invasive plant taken from Japan because it could feed livestock and get rid of bad plants. It helped greatly, but it also harmed greatly. It grew a little too well into its new environment. It started growing rapidly against trees, walls, and vines. It destroyed land and got rid of needed plants. Harmful or helpful? Are all invasives harmful? Actually, no. A recent study shows that some honeysuckle can be invasive, but has a positive effect onto the ecosystem. What does it do? Well, not only does it have the abundance of fruit-eating birds that feed off it, but it also has a positive effect on some of the native organisms around it. Or take the round gobies for an example.
They are invasive fish that are helping support the Great Lakes fishing industry in Michigan. They are a source of food to other fish around it and eat invasive mussels that disrupt the lake's ecosystem. So no, not all invasives are harmful. If you take the time to think about it, some can be quite helpful to us and to the environment. What can we do to help? One, keep it from coming in the first place. This means look at the major pathways. Look at what's being shipped to and from place to place and what's being taken in and out of the country. Two, gardeners. If you don't know it, don't grow it. This means if you bought a plant or a pack of seeds that you really don't know about, then don't grow it. It'll reduce your risk of having an invasive plant taking over your garden. Three, boaters and fishers. Do not take any aquatic plant, animal, or water from one body of water to another. Four, pet people. Protect yourselves, your pets, and wildlife from invaders and vectors. Also, do not take aquarium fish of any kind and place it into a natural body of water. Take action. Warn your family, friends, and neighbors about the harms invasives can bring. Watch out for common invaders, but keep a sharp eye out for new ones. Tell everybody about the harms invasives can bring. But it's your choice. Will you do what it takes?
Wepa, today I'll be talking to you about why Puerto Rico is great. First, here are some facts. Puerto Rico is a U.S. Commonwealth. You also don't need a passport to go there. Puerto Rico's currency is the same as the United States. Puerto Rico means rich port in Spanish. You will learn about Puerto Rico's culture, food, and history. Get ready. Puerto Rico is awesome because of its history. In the year 1492, on April 17th, Ferdinand and Isabella of Spain signed the agreement to finance and set the track of Columbus's voyage to the Indies. The document is known as the Capitulations of Santa Fe. In 1599, Taino Indians, who came from South America, inhabited the major portion of the island when the Spaniards arrived. Taino Indians lived in small villages organized in clans and led by a chief. They ate wild fruits such as pineapples, cassava, guava, soursop, and sea grapes. History can be fun if you want to learn. Puerto Rican food is traditional and tastes great. Some people may know what Puerto Rico's most famous seasoning is. It's adobo. Here's how you make Puerto Rican adobo. You need 1 tablespoon of garlic powder, 1 tablespoon of onion powder, 1 tablespoon of dried oregano, and 1/2 tablespoon of salt and black pepper. Traditional food from Puerto Rico tastes amazing, like chicken with rice and arroz con gandules, which is yellow rice with green pigeon peas. These are both examples of the wonderful food of Puerto Rico. Puerto Rican culture is somewhat complex. Others call it colorful. Let's consider Puerto Ricans represent a cultural and racial mix. During the 18th century, the Spaniards, in order to populate the country, took Taino Indian women as their brides. Later on, as labor was needed to maintain crops and build roads, African slaves were imported, followed by the importation of Chinese immigrants, then with the arrival of Italians, German, French, and even Lebanese people. Spanish immigrants come from the economically depressed Dominican Republic. This historic intermingling has resulted in a contemporary Puerto Rico practically without racial problems. Did you enjoy your walk through Puerto Rico's history, food, and culture? Puerto Rico is known as the Isle of Enchantment. Thank you for listening. Adios.
Vroom, vroom. My tiny orange chainsaw roars to life as my dad cuts branches with his real one. In my mind, this was serious work, and I tried to look tough. But my dad was grinning so wide you could fit a bed inside his smile. When I was little, I wanted to be just like my dad. Here's how it started. It was my birthday. I was turning a whopping 3. For such a momentous occasion, I was sure to have a load of magnificent gifts and stacked to the ceiling. Unfortunately for me, nobody else thought that was necessary. So they gave me the usual toy trucks or the article of clothing I dreaded most, socks. Once all the gifts had been unwrapped and the wrapping paper mutilated, my mom and dad came up to me with big grins, like they'd ripped one and nobody had noticed. They gently set 2 machines in front of me as I went ballistic with excitement. I had been given a chainsaw and a weed whacker, and it looked just like my dad's with real sounds too. I instantly knew I had found my true purpose in life. I was going to become a mini-me of my dad. Whatever he did, I would do, within reason. I would wash dishes and watch TV with my dad. I would cling to his side like a barnacle to a ship. One day, my dad decided to cut up dead orange trees in our grove to build a fire. He slipped on his work boots, and I had him lace up mine. We couldn't cut branches with our tree-tearing buddies, so I brought out my mechanical masterpiece, while my dad loped off to get his from the shed. Once we started cutting, I knew something was wrong. My chainsaw didn't tear the branches like my dad's. I punched my chainsaw and hit the branches with it, but it wouldn't cut. Finally, from rage, I took the twigs in my hands and snapped them myself. Later that day, I decided to cut the grass with my dad. This time, after we had gotten our boots on, we clasped our weed whackers to our chests and we strode outside. I turned mine on and revved up the engine, hitting the weeds with the plastic blades. Again, I felt frustrated because my weed whacker wouldn't cut. It just whacked. After that, I gave up trying to cut plants with my miserable machines and decided to be like my dad in other ways. I got in bed early and worked hard, exactly what my dad did. But whenever he went outside to mow or chop branches, I stayed inside watching cartoons. Now I'm like my dad because I'm smart, funny, and hardworking. We both love practical jokes and we prank our family constantly, though they don't always find it humorous. One day in the future, I might even become an environmentalist like him.
When you think of a hero, who do you think of? Spider-Man, Wonder Woman, or even Batman? I have a different person in mind, a man who serves his country. He's the kind of man who loves his family and cares for others. He is my Uncle Matthew. My Uncle Matthew was a U.S. Marine serving in the Middle East. He has a wife named Katie and a little girl named Kim, who's 4. They live in Miami, Florida. I only get to visit them 2 times a year, but it's a lot of fun. He reaches me by sending me email messages from the Middle East. Here are some messages that are most precious to me. October 24th. Dear Paige, I miss you and I hope you have a nice Halloween. I'm excited that it's only a few months until I get to come home. I want you to know that you're my favorite niece. Of course, yesterday that I'm his only niece. I will write back as soon as I can. I miss you. Hope to see you soon. Love, Uncle Matthew. October 30th. Dear Paige, it's starting to get really tough here. Many people here are not happy with us being around. Have you been having a great school year? I hope you can getting good grades. If you get straight A's, I'll be so proud of you. Love, Uncle Matthew. November 12th. Dear Paige, over here in the Middle East, it's harder every day. It seems like every time I turn around, someone's getting hurt. I miss you, Tumblr. He calls me that because when I was little, I used to tumble around instead of walking. Love, Uncle Matthew. November 16th. Dear Paige, Katie just told me they were coming down to Miami to see Katie and little Kim for Thanksgiving. I'm sad that I can't come, but I want to wish you a happy Thanksgiving. I can't wait to come home and give you a hug. I have a special gift that I want to give you for Christmas. Love, Uncle Matthew. December 22nd. I received an email from Aunt Katie. Dear Paige, I've already talked to your mom and dad. I have horrible news I'm sorry to share with you. Your Uncle Matthew was killed in war Friday. He would have wanted me to tell you that he loved you. I'm so sorry. Aunt Katie, P.S. I love you. My uncle is a real hero because he is a man who fought for what he believed in, family and justice. I just shared with you a fictional story, but there are countless people out there who have lost their loved ones in a fight against terrorism and the fight for freedom. So when you look at an American flag, remember those who have fought to defend it. These are some of our greatest heroes that we should never forget. Thank you.
Hey, do you guys feel like going on a road trip? Oh wait, you're stuck here listening to me. Well, how about you just join me on an imaginary road trip? You can be my passengers as we tour the most haunted place in the United States. Our destination is just a few hours from here in St. Augustine, Florida. Not only is this the oldest city in the continental United States, but it's one of the most historic as well. Luckily, I was able to visit this 450-year-old city last summer and even get to go on a ghost tour. One of the best-known ghost tours involves the St. Augustine Lighthouse.
Due to so many deaths in this lighthouse, people have reported hearing strange sounds and seeing unusual shadowy figures lurking around. In addition, employees of this lighthouse claim to smell a burning cigar scent a few times per week. This scent is believed to be the ghost of Peter Rasmussen, keeper of the lighthouse, who was always seen with a cigar. This place is so haunted, it's even been featured on an episode of Ghost Hunters. During this episode, the crew hears male and female voices, but can't figure where they are coming from. They hear a woman's voice say, "Help me." They see a shadow floating near lights, and they also have a video of them chasing something that climbed two flights of stairs in 2 seconds. It stopped and looked back at them over the railing. If that were me, I think I would have ran two flights of stairs in 2 seconds just to get out of there. Anyway, our next stop is a very pretty three-story pink building. Though it's pretty on the outside, it's anything but pretty on the inside. In fact, it's another one of St. Augustine's most haunted places. I'm talking about the old jail. This jail held 72 prisoners and had a torture cage and a hanging area. Due to diseases being spread, abuse, accidents, and executions, many prisoners died here and are now ghosts that haunt the old jail today. Some of the paranormal activity that happens here include the smell of sewage, a figure of a man sitting on a chair, the sounds of shuffling footsteps, and the jingling of chains. But the scariest reports are from the people who have actually felt the ghost. For example, a tour guide felt a punch in his side and then a cold hand moved down his back. Some have been tugged at, blown on, talked, or whistled to. Clearly, these ghosts have not gotten the memo that their time has been served and they are free to leave now. Well, if I had more time, we could continue our road trip and visit more haunted places, such as the Old Fort, the Huguenot Cemetery, Flagler College, and many bed and breakfasts. But since we don't have enough time, grab a pair this summer and you can visit the ghost for yourself, if you dare.
Come on, it's only a little cigarette. Let's go have some fun. Will it look cool or are you a chicken? Some kids make the wrong decision by smoking cigarettes when they are younger. They creep to the back of a building, pull out their Marlboro cigarettes, and puff their lungs away. Did I mention how bad they smell or how yellow their fingers look? I'm about to explain to you how smoking cigarettes will be one of the worst decisions in your whole entire life. It is a nasty habit that costs a lot of money and will ruin your long-term health. About 8.6 million people in the U.S. have at least one serious illness that is caused by smoking. Isn't that terrible? One very popular story is from one of our victims, Terry Hall. You might have seen her on a smoke-free campaign commercials. She showed you how to get rid of pneumonia if you are a smoker. First, your plastic teeth. Second, your wig. Third, your hands-free device, which you have to cover with a scarf. Lastly, you're ready for the day. Sad, right? Smoking is extremely critical to your health. You ladies and gentlemen out there are probably wondering what a hands-free device is, right? A hands-free device is a plastic piece which you use to cover the hole in your throat. Really? Why are you people smoking? Do you see the world around us? It's up to you to reject this filthy, life-threatening addiction. Out of all the terrible things that happened to Terry, I feel the worst is cancer. In fact, the reason that she needed a hands-free device is because in 2001, at the age of 40, Terry was diagnosed with oral cancer. Later in that same year, with throat cancer. Doctors informed her that they would need to remove her larynx. Now at age 51, she still battles cancer. When we think of cancers caused by smoking, we think of lung cancer, but smoking causes 30% of all cancers. These include head and neck cancer, liver cancer, breast cancer, prostate cancer, AML, and much, much more. Smoking also makes your breath smell like trash. Imagine somebody holding their nose as they walk by you. Wouldn't that make you feel terrible? I would hate it if someone would disrespect me like that, but I have to admit, I would try to stay away, too. Now you see how terrible and dirty smoking is. Do you still want to smoke? I didn't think so. The next time somebody asks you, "Hey, you want to try some?" You just say something like, "What on earth is your problem? Are you trying to kill me?" Thank you.
Can you imagine being lost at sea and all the power on your ship goes out? Or flying in an airplane in the summer when a severe storm hits out of nowhere, pushing you towards the deep blue waters of the ocean? More than 1,000 ships and planes have vanished in the past 5 centuries in the Bermuda Triangle. Sometimes ships and planes seem to vanish into thin air even when there are no human errors, equipment failure, or even natural disasters. The three points of the Bermuda Triangle are located at Miami, Florida, the Bermuda Islands, and San Juan, Puerto Rico. It is one of the most traveled places by both ships and planes. There are many theories about all the disappearances. Charles Berlitz believes that the lost city of Atlantis lies beneath the waters of where the Bermuda Triangle is. He thinks that Atlantis is what causes all the disappearances. Others believe that there have been sudden tidal waves that could sink small boats, or maybe some mysterious magnetic force that causes ships and planes to crash and sink. As I stated before, 1,000 ships and planes seem to vanish into thin air in the Bermuda Triangle. Some of those ships and planes are the USS Cyclops, the Five Avengers, and the SS Marine Sulphur Queen. The USS Cyclops disappeared in 1918. It was supposed to arrive in Maryland, but it never did. Some people believe that it sunk in the Bermuda Triangle because it has the same qualities of a disappearance in the Bermuda Triangle. The Five Avengers were five planes that were lost on December 5, 1945. There were 13 people in the five planes practicing flying when their compasses stopped working. The Five Avengers were lost in the Bermuda Triangle for a while until finally an air traffic controller told them how to get back to their base. Another ship that disappeared there is the SS Marine Sulphur Queen. It disappeared in 1963. The SS Marine Sulphur Queen disappeared off the southern coast of Florida. Wreckage from the ship has never been found. One of the other planes that disappeared in the Bermuda Triangle is Flight of NC-16002. Flight of NC-16002 vanished on December 28, 1948. The pilot and his crew were flying from San Juan, Puerto Rico to Miami, Florida. The weather was fine and the pilot and his crew were 50 miles away from Florida when the plane disappeared. Now that you know the stories of the Bermuda Triangle, why do you think ships and planes disappear there? Do you think these stories are real, or is the mystery of the Bermuda Triangle a myth? The mystery of the Bermuda Triangle still remains unsolved.
Have you ever wondered to yourself, what would I do if I won the lottery? Well, I certainly know what I would do. Or, at least I thought I did. I mean, come on, how many people actually win the lottery? As I thought about it, I decided to Google how many people play the lottery versus how many people win. Statistics provided that approximately 1,500 people win at least $1 million yearly, and about 5 million people play daily. This means 1,825,500,000 people play each year. That's a lot of numbers. Now, I'll let you guys in on a little secret on how to increase your odds of winning. Save up a lot of money and don't play as often. When you have a decent amount of money, you buy as many tickets as you can. This may sound ridiculous, but a girl's gotta do what a girl's gotta do. Join a lottery pool with others who are willing to share a winning lottery ticket. Finally, and most importantly, it's all about the attitude, people. Go insane, winner, or walk out looking like a winner. Now that I've properly informed you of facts, I want you to remember this face. You see, when I win the lottery, oh, that's right, I said when, not if, because you can't have that kind of attitude. You'll see this face on Good Morning America, and Robin Roberts will announce, congratulations to Amandine Marrero, the new multi-million lotto winner. That's when you'll say, wow, she really did it. After careful considerations, these are a few things I'll acquire with my winnings. Go to Forever 21 and purchase plenty of clothes. Forget that. This girl right here is going to own a Forever 21 and have unlimited outfits at my disposal. Open a free state-of-the-art school that will have an amazing campus equipped with iPads for each student, a fully equipped fitness center, an amazing library, and a gourmet cafeteria. Because, let's face it, people, school lunch bites. Have you seen what they serve your children? Buy five first-class tickets for me and my family to go to my forever-loving hometown, New York. Spend 5 days there and enjoy the familiar sights. Rent a private jet so that I could go to every Alicia Keys concert with my mom. You see, like Miss Keys, we were born in the Empire State, our beloved concrete jungle, and have similar stories of survival. Now that girl can sing. My ultimate goal is to give half of my proceeds to my loving parents who will always have my best interest at heart. So, if you're skeptical about your odds in winning, know that 3 to 4 people win the lottery each day for various amounts. So, go get your tickets. Like, now. Well, what are you waiting for? I said now. Good luck.
Across the streets are the doors to a horrific, horrifying place where kids rapidly run through hallways so fast they will leave shoe prints on your face from running you over. Ugh, I quiver in my shoes just thinking about it. This dreadful place is called middle school. Very terrifying events happen in that mess of a jungle. Not to mention when you're going to be a sixth grader, you're scared you'll get turned into cafeteria food. Also, you have popularity, the number one standard in middle school. Every girl wants to be the golden girl, that special girl who wears the designer clothes and has all the boys follow her around like a lovesick puppy. If not, sorry ladies, you're dead meat. I've heard rumors about swirlies, aka a toilet shampoo. Therefore, you have a variety of consequences, like being shoved into a locker, and the most petrifying one of all time, we do physical education. P.E., the place where everyone is best friends and you do fun, easy activities, and coaches are nurturing. Wrong. The coaches are like drill sergeants barking orders at you. And don't even get me started on their Olympic-like obstacles. They expect us to run 4 laps around the track. 4. I can barely get to my desk and it's 18 feet away from me. Uh-oh, 8th graders. Kings, queens, equal 8th graders. Oh, why? Why can I just stay in 5th grade? I love being head of the school with loads of special treatment from the younger kids. With 8th graders, you will be lucky not to get beat up. The cafeteria, a place where snarling lunch ladies serve their hungry beast. Okay, I'm going in. So all I have to do is squeeze through a bunch of hormonal 8th graders, grab my repulsive lunch, and run for my life. Sounds easy enough? Sure. What? You don't believe me? Well, I actually interviewed a 6th grader, and my information is true. So you can believe it or not. But beware, there's no going back now. Unless our 5th grade teachers fail us all.
Do you have parents that fight a lot?
I do. I learned that there is a name for the way my parents act, and it's called the circle of violence. And it has 3 stages called tension, violence, and the honeymoon. First up is tension stage. Tension is when 2 people are not getting along, so they pick at each other, argue, and threaten each other. They start off by just arguing back and forth. My mom starts off by saying, "Leave. I don't even need you." Sometimes I'm there like, "Please don't leave. Please don't leave." One day, we were going to visit my cousin in Tampa, and it went wrong. My dad was saying some things to my mom, and my mom got really mad. She was telling my dad to turn back and go home. My dad didn't listen, and my mom started moving the steering wheel, and we were so scared. But luckily, nothing happened. So then the next day, my friend Cynthia came over to my house, and I heard arguing, and I'm thinking, "Oh no, not again." The second stage is the violence stage. This is the stage when somebody usually gets hurt the most. In this stage, my parents start yelling and cursing. It gets more violent when they start throwing things like books, paper, and even my little sister's dirty diapers. Yuck. My dad just left at 6:30 a.m. and came back at 8:57 p.m. I don't know where he went, and he didn't tell us either. He told us not to worry about it. When he came home, he tried to sleep on my mom's bed, but my mom kept on pushing him off the bed. They didn't talk the whole entire day. The final stage is the honeymoon stage. This stage is when the violence ends. In the next few days, my dad went into my mom's room and said, "I'm sorry I act that way." My mom would just walk away. My dad would follow her and say the same thing all over again. He started hugging her and giving her kisses. My mom would smile, but wouldn't say anything. When my dad came after work, he bought my mom 2 dozen roses, a card that said, "I love you, you are my everything," and a box of chocolates. But the best thing of all, a big bear. Then the next day, my mom told us we had to stay with my aunt for 1 day. She said that her and my dad were going somewhere for a while. After they came back, my dad said it was the best day. My mom said she loved it. Beware of the circle of violence. If you are stuck in the honeymoon stage, it's great. But the tension and violence is not a good way to live. It makes you feel uneasy, like you never know what will happen next. I hope that someday my parents will break this cycle.
Our honorable mention goes to Hannah Guevara from Oakstead Elementary for Leader or Follower. Third place winner is Sophia Gazar from Seven Oaks Elementary, Cyberbullying. Our second place winner is Logan Culp from Wesley Chapel Elementary, Inspired by Batman. Finally, our first place winner, Mason Satin from Lake Myrtle Elementary, The Roar of the Crowd.